upon this earth. We realize that our moms are some of the ones who teach us most, right? They teach us the logic of, because I said so, that's why. And teach us foresight, make sure you wear clean underwear in case you're in an accident. Teach us irony. Keep laughing or I'll give you something to cry about. All right, let's take a moment to pray and ask God for wisdom as we look at his word. Father, we thank you. We thank you for moms. Lord, the way that they care for us and love us, such a picture of you. And Lord, we realize that that's part of the reason why you've put them in the places that you have. Lord, we pray your blessing upon them. We pray, Father, that you would encourage and strengthen them. And Father, we pray that you would speak to each and every one of us, for your word does. It has instructions for every one of us. And so as we look this morning, may we hear you speak and may we respond correctly. In Christ's name, amen. Last week we talked about 2 Corinthians chapter 3, and we'll talk about 2 Corinthians 4, and I thought about, well, maybe I should do a special Mother's Day message this morning, and as I was laying out my schedule and realized we were going to be in 2 Corinthians 4, I realized that this really was a Mother's Day message, therefore do not lose heart, okay? Twice it comes up in this chapter. But even last week's message, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, where it's talking about God making us sufficient as ministers, as servants of Christ, okay? Think through this, okay? God has placed you primarily as a servant of his, as a minister of his, to share the gospel with the world around you, okay? And sometimes that looks like being a mom, right? That God has placed you as a mother, and he has made you sufficient to be able to carry out that task that he's given for you. It might be as a dad, okay? It might be as a kid. It might be as an employee. It might be as a husband, as a wife. God has made you sufficient for that task, and does. Unfortunately, as we're sharing the gospel, as we're being a minister of the gospel, we do need to remember, Paul bring it up again in this chapter, but the world is blinded to that, right? They don't understand. And until God removes that veil and opens our minds and thoughts to his truth and the spirit of liberty that there is in forgiveness, then we're blinded as well. But fortunately, for many of us, he's taken away that veil, and his desire is to transform us into the image of his son, so that as a mom, we respond as Jesus would in a certain situation, as a dad, as a parent, as a child, as a husband, wife, right? God's desire is to transform us into the image of his son. And that brings us to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. If you would, follow along in your copy of God's Word. 2 Corinthians 4:1 says, "Therefore, since we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart." All right, so Paul's gone through a lot, okay? His autobiography, things that he records, other things that we know about him, he went through a lot of hardship for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul says, I don't want to lose heart. You shouldn't lose heart. Partly because we have received mercy. God has not given us what we do deserve. What we do deserve is eternal punishment for our sin. Eternal punishment for our rebellion against God, for our saying, God, I can do it my own way. Right? A lot of you mothers have corrected that particular attitude in your children, right? And God, no less. Right? if we rebel against God, that is sin, and it is deserving of eternal punishment. But we've received mercy. God doesn't just sweep it under the rug. He doesn't just overlook our sin. What he did was he provided a way, right? He provided Jesus Christ, his son, came to earth, lived a perfect life, died on a cross for our sin. He offered himself up as a payment for our sin so that God could righteously look and say, okay, well, that sin's been paid for. So when we accept what Jesus Christ has done for us, then we can receive that mercy. And God doesn't give us what we do deserve, which is punishment. Paul says, look, if you've received that if you've received that mercy, doesn't that make sense? That you would respond in love to him, that you would serve him. And furthermore, doesn't it make sense that if there was no way that you could save yourself, if there was no way that you could work your way towards heaven, there's no way that you could do enough good works, there was nothing you could do. You couldn't buy off God, all right? You couldn't sweet talk him. If God took you out of that impossible situation where you were destined for hell, and he provided a way and saved you miraculously, doesn't that make sense that whatever hardship you're going through now, God can save you? God can deliver you? That you can't come up with a problem big enough that's bigger than God? I don't know about you, but one of the things that causes me to lose heart, causes me to doubt, is worry, okay? Lord, I'm just not doing a good enough job. Lord, this is going wrong, this is going wrong. All right, I came across a very interesting thought in my study. And the thought was this: if you know how to worry, you know how to meditate. Yeah, you see the point already. All you need to do is change what you think about, and you will be practicing Christian meditation. Do you get it? I mean, when you worry, you're fixated on the problem and how it can't be resolved. And what God's saying is what you're supposed to be doing is you're supposed to be thinking on my truth and meditating on my truth and trusting my truth and letting that go over and 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 over, and over again in your mind. And that's meditating on his word, on his truth. All right? Do not lose heart. Paul goes on to say, but we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. As ministers of his, we're to portray the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. All right? And we're not as the false apostles that Paul talks about later in the letter. We're not, as they did, to sugarcoat it, to back off and not stick to the truth, okay? We have renounced secret ways. We refuse to wear masks. We've renounced shameful ways. We would not do anything that, if discovered, we would be ashamed about. We do not use deception. We don't maneuver or manipulate behind the scenes. We don't distort the word of God. We don't twist God's word to suit ourselves, okay? We must live the word of God without apology. Is that going to be easy? Not at all, right? If in our culture you say that marriage is defined by one man, one woman for life, the culture goes, that's restrictive, that's old-fashioned, that can't be right. And we go to God's word and we say, that's what it says. That's what it means. That's the way we have to live. Now, that doesn't mean that we're confrontational or we're you know, mean or cruel, but it means that we don't back off. That as we have the truth of the word of God, that we don't manipulate it, we don't back off, we say what it says, and we live it out in the way that God would have us to do that. The problem is, even if our gospel is veiled, verse 3, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. Some don't understand. Some won't understand. If you're blind, you can't see the light. That's why God has to do a work in hearts of people, right? To remove the veil, to open their eyes, to make them aware of their sin and of the consequences of their sin and of their need for a Savior so that they will respond. And when they get that fundamental issue settled and right, then they can respond correctly to all of the other things that God's word reveals to us. Paul says, look, it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So Paul goes all the way back to the creation story, right? There was nothing. It was chaos. It was without form and void, okay? And God said, let there be light. And boom, everything totally changed. Everything totally changed. In that same way, you and I are without understanding of the gospel. Your neighbor maybe is without understanding. Your family members are maybe without understanding. And God shines this glorious light of the gospel. And it must create a transformation. Everything's got to be different. And when it's different, when we've accepted what Christ has done for us on the cross, when we become God's child, when we become a new creation, God puts within us the light of his gospel, right? And our job is to reflect that light, to let that light shine through us. That's what verse 7 is talking about. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. All right? So it's a little hard for us to kind of put it into the same kind of perspective, okay? But it's like a light bulb, okay, that burns, okay? What Paul's saying is that it's not of much consequence, okay, the container itself. The kind of clay pots that he's looking at, talking about, were just little pieces of clay that they would just fold together, put a little oil in, and it would burn. They knock it off the shelf, no big deal, right? It's expendable. It's changed the light bulb, right? It's not worth much on its own. What is valuable is the message that's contained. The container is nothing, but what's contained within it is everything. That the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. Right? The super apostles, the false apostles, were saying, you know, how grand and glorious they were and how polished the speakers they were. And Paul says, look, it's really not about that. We're clay pots. We're expendable. It's hard to think through this without the image of Gideon and Judges. All right, and the fact that they were told the 300, after God had winnowed down the army, 300 against a great multitude, that God said, okay, what I want you to do is take a torch and a pot and a trumpet, all right? So when I tell you it's time, you break the pot, the light will shine, all right? And that's the idea here. Let the light shine. In other words, God's calling you to be a cracked pot, okay? All right? You're better off as a crackpot because the light shines through. All right? That is the idea. It's not the container. It's the message inside. God needs to shine through you. The glory, the message of the glory of his grace, right? 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8. We are hard pressed on every side. Is this going to be easy to do? No. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about the body, the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So then death is working in us, but life in you. Since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke. We also believe and therefore speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. It's hard in where we live, I think, to think through the fact that people die because they come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. In other countries, where people are persecuted to the point of death, I think they understand this concept a whole lot better. We get picked on at work, or we get made fun of, and we think, wow, that's persecution. And it is, but it's nowhere near the level of which Paul is talking about here. That those who minister the gospel of Jesus Christ are hard-pressed on every side, yet not crushed. Perplexed. They don't understand what's going on. We don't always understand, but we're not in despair. We're persecuted, but we're not forsaken. Suffering may come, but God doesn't abandon us. We are struck down, but not destroyed. Okay, so if you want to think through that, here's Paul's life example of that. Okay, in Acts chapter 14, Paul goes to the town of Lystra. Okay, he begins to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. They drag him outside of the city. They stone him. Okay, fist-sized rocks. They throw fist-sized rocks at him and then leave him for dead because they think they've killed him. All right? And they go away. The believers come to see if he's all right. He rises up and goes back into the city. Okay, so my first thought would be, after you get stoned in the city, that's the only chance they get. I'm going somewhere else next. Not Paul. Paul goes back in among them to demonstrate that the power of God is bigger than the bullies, okay? That even though they may kill him, God has power to resurrect, and God has power to reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul says we're struck down, but not destroyed. In that passage that we read, he talked there in verse 13, I believed and therefore I spoke. If you hold your place in 2 Corinthians, but go to Psalm 116. The quote is from Psalm 116, verse 10. And this chapter also holds one of the verses that we often quote, but look at it in the context that we're talking about here. Paul says, I believe, therefore I spoke. I am greatly afflicted. Okay? So he's quoting from this chapter, and this chapter is not going to be a chapter about, you know, I don't want to quite say it this way. It's not a chapter about how great God is, because it is a chapter about how great God is. But that doesn't seem to be what you were thinking of, is how great God is. He's going to talk about his sickness, his affliction. Verse 11, I said in my haste, all men are liars. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I will take up the cup of salvation, call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord now in the presence of all his people. Verse 15, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Paul says, look, I realize that if I'm preaching Christ, this may be my death. I may suffer to the point of death, hardship. But God has the power to raise the dead. And so, should I worry that he's taking me and putting me in hard places and hard times? If he chooses that I would die for his sake, should I worry? No. Because God has resurrection power. Finishes this chapter up with that thought again. Verse 16. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Why? Because God can take you back from the dead. That we win in the end. That even should we die here in this body, in this time, that if we have trusted in Christ as our Savior, then we win our eternal life. Eternal time with Him. We do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction. Okay, so that being stoned and left for dead, that counts as light affliction. You measure your own in accordance. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Right? For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us. Okay? Notice that what he doesn't say, Spirit of God giving him inspiration, revealing God's truth to us, what he doesn't say is, hang on, suffer through the persecution. After the persecution, after the suffering, there's reward. Now, there is reward after suffering, but what he says is the suffering produces the reward. The suffering produces the reward. So, I enter into this hesitantly as well. We should pray, oh God, keep me from all suffering. We're going to lose out on the reward. It is the suffering that produces the reward. Paul is talking about his daily death, right? His outward man is perishing in it. And we sometimes use this and think about this as, you know, we're just getting older, our bodies are falling apart. And it's true, we're older, my body's falling apart, right? But that's not all that he has in mind there, okay? Because that would be true of everyone. In the context that he's talking about the fact that because of the gospel, he is actually suffering. And because of the gospel, he's suffering that which is shortening his life. His outward man is perishing because of his choice to live for God. But his choice to live for God is what is strengthening his inward man, the spiritual growth is bringing about, is producing in him that which would not otherwise take place. When we compare our earthly afflictions for Christ's sake with the future glory God has for us, there's no comparison, right? Our present suffering is temporary, short in duration, even if it lasted 100 years. That's short in duration compared to our heavenly reward of glory, which is eternal. It has no end. And then I came across this thought as well. I don't know how you think of rewards, okay? Whether you think through and think, you know, I wonder how much God's going to reward me if I pray for an hour. Or, you know, what's the reward for teaching Sunday school for 40 years? Right? What do I get as much as Billy Graham? Right? Do you think about that? I mean, what is the expected reward for X? Well, I came across this thought, which I shouldn't know. I don't think I'd ever thought of it in this way. Let me read part of this. If I understand the scriptures correctly, our heavenly rewards are certainly related to our earthly faithfulness. But rewards are not mere compensation for our works. Like every other blessing of God, rewards are based upon grace, not works. We are not able to do anything worthy of God's approval or rewards. He accomplishes in and through us that which he rewards. And the blessings are not commensurate with our faithfulness. How insignificant our earthly deeds will seem in heaven compared to the magnitude of God's blessings. Paul's words indicate that whatever price we pay will in no way be equivalent to the rewards we receive. Like every other blessing of God, rewards are by grace, and they far exceed what we deserve. For in reality, we deserve nothing. The ability to view our present bodily suffering for Christ's sake as a light and momentary affliction is based upon a Christian perspective possible only for those who operate by faith rather than by sight. Do you understand? God not only shows us mercy, starting off the chapter, by not giving us the punishment we deserve if we trust in Christ as our Savior. But as Paul comes to the end of this chapter, his reminder is that God not only shows mercy, but God shows grace. God gives us things that we don't deserve. He gives us a reward that we truly don't deserve. Okay? So I realize some of you moms will get homemade cards today that weren't made by Hallmark. Okay? And I've made a few of them myself. Okay? And I'm sure that the first thing my mother thought of was not, oh my, you should have colored within the lines a little better. Oh my, you know, the choice of colors here, plaid and polka dots. Never my mom's, what? She rewarded that far above and beyond what it deserved. God looks at our meager efforts and he doesn't reward us in compensation for that. His grace goes far above and beyond. Amazing. Is our faithfulness worked in there? Yes, somehow. Our heart, our attitude, our motivation is all worked in there. But think about it. If God really rewarded us on our efforts, eternal and exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Right? Do not lose heart. God has made you sufficient for whatever ministry he's put you in, whether that's as a mom or a dad, as an employee, an employer. Right? He has made us sufficient. Let us work and serve him as we should. Let's pray. Father God, I ask for you to speak through your word more than through my words. Father, that if there are those here this morning who have never trusted Christ as their Savior, Lord God, they would realize that that is the primary thing. That apart from your merciful provision of a Savior, they would spend eternity in hell. So, Father, I pray that those who have not yet made that decision would make that decision even today. Father, for those who have made that decision, Lord, I pray that we would work, we would submit ourselves to you so that we would indeed be clay pots, earthen vessels to be used of you in whatever way you choose. And Father, we would rely upon you for the strength and the power to do all that you ask of us. To not lose heart, not to throw up our hands and walk away, but to serve you. Whether that's in the role of parent or child, whatever role you've given us. Lord God, we would do that well. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Let me encourage you as always.